Howdy once again, it's tubalcain, and I'm standing here before my Walker Turner drill press, and this is tips 481. Be sure and watch the several tips before this particular one and the following ones. And I've been doing a series here on DC motors and controllers, and I've already got it up and running in the last videos, but in this one I'm going to do several things. I'm going to experiment here. I'm going to take meter readings. I'm going to install a reversing switch, I hope, if it works, and also do some very unscientific torque testing here to see how much power, that's probably not the word, that we have with this at a very slow speed with this DC motor. So thanks for watching, and here we go. When you work on electrical panels, it's a good practice to unplug it and even have the plug sitting here someplace where you can see it and reminds yourself at all times that it is unplugged. So let me take the cover off. I already took the screws out. And you've seen the inside of this box before. But notice here that there's a blank here. Well, actually, here's the blank. And there is space for a forward reversing switch, also with a brake. Now, I don't have the brake. That's $75 from this company. So I'm just using some switches here I had in stock. Now, I don't know what the amperage is on these, but this, I think, is a rather light one because the wires are light that are on there. It's used. I'm going to use, and this is a double pull, double throw. It will not have the brake, so it's got three positions. Three positions. Well, same with this one, but I think this is a triple pull, triple throw. I don't know what that's all about, but again, three positions. This looks a little heavier duty. It is not marked as to the rating, so I'm just going to go ahead and install it. If it doesn't work, I'll go to Ace Hardware. They're $10 and get a switch and put it in there. I like this one because, for two reasons. It's already got the crisscrosses in here, whatever you call those jumpers, so I don't have to do that as I wire here. And I just will not use 1, 2, 3, that side of the switch. I'll be using 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I'll be using those screws. Now, I won't go into too much detail, but that's where it mounts, and I have to make some jumper wires and some connections in there. Hopefully this will work. Why am I putting reverse in? There might be times when I want to do some tapping or something like that, and it's just a minor challenge, so I'm going to go ahead and do it right now. Remember, what I'm showing you here about reversing the motor applies only to direct current motors, certainly not to alternating current. So with that said, here we go. I will remove this wire from this terminal and from this terminal, and those are the armature terminals. Now, you can easily reverse the direction of the motor here without a switch just by swapping the red wire here with the white wire. And I did that earlier off camera because when I hooked this up, the motor was going the wrong way. So it's very easy to do if you're not interested in a reversing switch. You just swap the wires. Now, I've got a couple jumper wires here left from another project that I'm going to use. And I will put two of them. Remember, ignore this one. I'm going to cover it with my thumb. I'll put these two wires here, the black and the red, one on this terminal and one on this terminal. And then from the other two terminals, I will use these jumper wires and put those on this terminal and this terminal. So it's really pretty simple because we already have these links on here. I don't have to deal with that. When I'm doing wiring or other mechanical repairs, with my memory and everything, sometimes I take a picture before I start so that if I get in trouble, I at least can go back and put the thing together the way it was originally. So that's just a tip. I think a lot of you do that as well. All right, look what I've done here. Well, these two wires here, the red and the white, are at the bottom of the switch. And then the two that came out of the control, which is that black and that red, which I guess you could, I call them the hot wires, they go to the middle. That's all there is to it. This has a little groove here, so it has to be installed in the correct position here in to the hole. In other words, it's a key. All right, take it for a test run here before I close this up. I'm going to take some meter readings here. That's why I still got that open, but watch the sanding drum right here, which is also part of this particular video. But again, we got three positions here. So for forward, it has to be up. And of course, we have the on and off here. So that's forward. Neutral or stop, but make sure that the motor stops before you put it into reverse. And there we are, and it worked the first time, which surprises me as much as it probably surprises you. Now, if you look at the contacts here, the terminals, I should say, the two on the far right are the input lines, so they'll be household voltage here, which is around 110, so I'll measure that in a second. These two terminals go to the field windings in the DC motor. These two go to the armature, and that's what can reverse the motor. So first let's check the AC voltage. These other ones are DC voltage. All right, I'm set on AC here. This is the input voltage. 120 volts, more or less. Now I'll switch this to DC. Right next to my service box, I have a nice meter here that I bought for $5 at a garage sale last year, so you can see what the line voltage is here also. Just a little over 120. For years, I used one of these just plugged into the outlet, and now it doesn't work anymore. I went to look at it a few minutes ago, it doesn't work, so that goes in the trash. Why would I keep it when I got a nice one like that? Okay, we'll check the voltage now at the field connections. So it's 105 volts. Notice that there's a minus there. Now when I swap the two leads, it's now positive. Now I'm running at a real slow speed, it's still 105 volts, so I'm going to crank up the speed of the motor and note that the voltage did not really change for the fields. Now let's check the armature. I'm on the armature terminals with my voltmeter now, and watch what happens when I turn it on. We're at a low speed now, and we got 27 volts going into the armature. So that's how we get our speed control here, by varying the voltage. And let me speed it up now, watch the meter. And now that I'm at full blast, it's 127 volts. Notice that there's no positive shown there, but that means that it's positive. Let me turn this off right here and put it in reverse. Now watch to see if the negative shows up here. And it does. I'm on 127 volts negative. So you can see that the reversing switch here is reversing the polarity, and that's what's changing the direction of rotation on this direct current motor. Do you find that interesting? I find it fascinating, even though I'm 75 years old. All right, enough with the voltmeter. For all of those of you out there that are safety Nazis, I put the cover on, so that should make you happy. Now let's take some amperage readings. And you have to split your wires, you know, so I have a test cord I use here, but not the green one. And we'll just put the amp meter and set it for... All right. And I'll turn it on. And surprisingly enough, I'm only getting 2.5 amps. So that seems so low, because I thought this was 6 or 7 amps, that I checked it with another meter, and I'll do that now here just to verify it. So I'll take that one off. And that one reads the same. Let me get it closer here. Let's see, I'm on the 6-amp scale. So that's the reading closest to the black case. So you can see it's 2.5 amps there as well. And that's with the motor running full bore. So the amperage there is much lower than I would have expected. Sometimes I like an analog meter because you can watch the needle go one way or another rather than jumping around digitally. But watch what happens now when I start the drill press. It'll really jump way, way over the 2 or 3 amps. Here we go. See, it jumped up to what, 5 or 6 amps to start with. You see why I like the analog meter? Okay, now what I'm going to do is show you how the amperage increases as I impose a load. Remember, there's no load here other than the load of the motor being forced to rotate the spindle. So let's put a load on, but let me tell you how I'm going to do that. This is a hickory bar, 3 feet long, and I had a whole bundle of these. They came from a farm store, and I believe they're called Pittman arms, and that's what was used on a sickle mower as a safety mechanism. In other words, it was the weak link and could break if they ran into a fence post or something. I think that's what it's for. But what I'm doing here is, with this, and using the post here as my fulcrum, I'm bringing this up against this 3-inch abrasive disc and forcing a load on it. Now I know that's bad on the bearings, I don't care. I got 5 drill presses, why would I care? And 5 years to live, so what difference could it possibly make? So let me show you without the meter first how I'm doing this. And this is with the, well, I'll put it at a medium speed. You can see the whole thing flexing here, can't you? All right, now let me get the meter up and you can watch that. Is this as interesting to you as it is to me? I'm entertaining myself. At idle, and now with my right hand, I can bring it up almost to 6 amps, can't I? So there's a big difference in the current draw when it's under load. In order to make this video, I moved the drill press out of this corner. It's been there for years. The Delta drill press is right there. But I'm never really able to get at this tool panel. So it gave me an excellent chance here to examine the tools. There's things there that I didn't know I had. But back in the corner where I keep some of my stock, I had a metal 5-gallon can that was totally rusted through, and all the steel bars are rusted at the bottom. Not that it matters much, because that'll clean up or saw off, but there were tons of metal chips back there. I wish I had it open like this all the time. This is just so nice, but that drill press is going to have to go back in this relatively messy corner. Also, I kind of went through this shelf here to see what I got. It's amazing when you're a pack rat how much stuff you got that you don't know that you have. It's almost embarrassing. Do not call the authorities on me, please. Now, I'll tell you why I'm doing this experiment, and in the next video I'm going to drill some holes. I know this has nothing to do with metalworking, but I was greatly criticized when I started this by some people saying, well, those DC motors are worthless at low speed, you're going to stall them. Well, I did some experimenting here off camera an hour ago with this, and at one point I was not able to stall the motor. I was able to make the belt slip on the top pulley, the small one. And so I tightened it up, so that's as tight as a guitar string right now, almost. So I'm going to put the drill press at a slow speed. I don't know what the RPM is, but you'll have to admit that's fairly slow. And let's see if I can stall it now, and I'm holding the very end of the bar. But the whole drill press wants to flip over. It's not mounted to the floor, so I guess I have to put my foot on the base of the drill press so I don't flip it. Now let's see if I can stall it or make the belt slip. I believe I did slow it some. I was unable to stall it at whatever RPM this is. I was unable to make the belt slip. So to me, that's pretty amazing. But the truth will come out in the next video where I drill some big holes. So I hope you liked the experimentation on the electrical part here. I deviated a little bit from metalworking, but I think some of you will enjoy that. Let me know in the notes if you like what I'm doing, and give me a thumbs up if I deserve it, and there'll always be some thumbs down, even if I stand on my head. So this is Tubalcain saying so long for now, and I'll see you in my next video, I hope.